Assalamu alaikum, greetings, and welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. Brothers and sisters, we are streaming live. So if you'd like to participate in today's conversation, please give us a call at 773-434-6625. I have a very exciting and informative show scheduled for today. But before I introduce our guests, I'd like to remind you to please follow us on our social media platforms, which include Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And when on YouTube, please click that subscribe button so you can be notified whenever we post a show. Brothers and sisters, I am so excited to be joined today by two distinguished guests that are known throughout the Chicagoland community for disseminating information. They are people who I consider to be friends and brothers. Joining me in studio, I have the urban translator, the person who does the Bradley Report, Wallace Gator Bradley. Welcome to the show, brother.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you. And joining us via Zoom, I have our brother from the Maze Jackson page, What's In It for Black People Media, the Maze Jackson Show, Maze Jackson. Welcome to the show, brother.
Thank you. Honored to be here and honored to be one of your distinguished guests. Shout out to my man, Wallace Gator Bradley, and the Gator and the Bradley Report is there. I think I've been in that. Not always on the good side.
Hey, but it's always the right side. Because right. One thing for sure, you're gonna check me and make me a better gator.
That's my thing. That's my thing. I appreciate it. So I'm honored to be here.
Yes, thank you. And I think that's the beauty of the show. I think we all have our platforms. We all try to share information with the community, whether people like it or not, you know. But we have to just put it out there and let people form their own opinions. But in many times, you know, dealing with our community, you know, we're selective with our outrage, we're selective with our passions. But the one thing I'm pleased and honored with all of you, and there are other people, of course, in media in Chicago, in the black independent media who are trying to put out information, but I appreciate you both for your consistency and your dedication to that. And look, today's show, and I'm going to tell you straight up, you know, for those of you in the viewing audience, we wanted to just pose the question, should black elected officials be accountable to the black community? And we want you to call in with your opinions. I know that we're going to have some differences in opinion, but we want to kind of talk through this to make sure that we have a healthy and robust discussion, because this is something that happens all the time.
All the time.
As you all know, we've had countless number of black elected officials at all different levels of the government, but the condition of the people does not seem to necessarily change. You know, each election cycle, we're campaigning and requesting the same things. There's always confusion about what is an actual black agenda. And so let's just talk about the political process and elected officials and how it impacts the black community. And so I want to start off with you, Gator, first of all. You know, with this, you've been in the political scene for quite some time, and you have an extensive history in that, whether it's on the community levels, the grassroots levels, on all sides of it. You work with a lot of elected officials,
right?
You know, trying to put forth an agenda. So talk to us a little bit about that accountability piece that we're talking about.
You know, as we were talking earlier, and I have to agree with Mays, that accountability works even for the political consultants that bring elected officials or those that want to run for office to the community based off of a promise that we sell into the community.
Right.
Where the candidate's going to do what he's going to do because I'm going to see to him doing it.
Yeah.
So therefore, that makes me accountable because if he falls and he don't do it, I got to be held accountable for his actions.
Yeah, and for those in our viewing audience, what Wallace is talking about, because many people, we wouldn't necessarily give them an audience unless they were given a stamp of approval or bought to us by someone in the community. And so, Gator, I wanted to make sure that they knew that because, you know, and we've had conversations.
Right.
You've reached out to me about certain people who want to do things in the community, and so we might give them a forum. And so just talk about that process, what it looks like for you.
For me. Mm-hmm. Like J.B. Prisker, how I became an individual to work his campaign, it wasn't because an elected official suggested me to him. I just happened to be at the right place at the right time. And one of the things that I felt he was sincere about, because, you know, I worked at criminal justice reform piece, helping to free those that's wrongfully convicted. I saw we had put $100 million into that. But fast forward, when he chose not to bring me into his administration, he killed my responsibility of accountability to those who I convinced to elect him. Had I been a part of the administration, I would immediately told him, there's nowhere in the world you're going to let everybody else have a dispensary. An African-American ain't got it, going to have a dispensary. I would have been able, if I was in his administration, I would have been able to even let the Black caucus know there ain't nowhere in the world y'all can vote for something that's not guaranteeing that African-Americans going to get their slice. And then we find out that them people done sold $1 billion worth of marijuana, no African American got nothing but tricked twice.
But with that, you shouldn't have to be necessarily in the administration for him to know that or to realize that over somebody.
Too. But see, it was three different sets of people picking candidates. And all of us sit down and we all agreed on the agenda. If your candidate won, everybody looking to you to make sure that that agenda get addressed. If my candidate won, everybody gonna make sure, but to make sure that that happened, my move was supposed to have been an outreach person, just like Nancy Jefferson had a Joe Banks. You follow what I'm saying? So we had a platform. So what our community do, what was done to me. Well, Gator shouldn't be a part of the administration and he shouldn't be here. We'll handle it. And when they get to handling it, nothing happens. You follow what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Just like this nursing home piece that I'm talking about.
Well, let me say this. Before we get into the nursing home, I want to go to Mays because, you know, what Gator described is what traditionally has happened countless times, Mays. And you have the platform that you have the trademark, What's in it for Black People. So I know that's really, that's right up your alley with this. Right. And so just talk a little bit about what Gator shared so far, just on that platform.
So let me start here. First of all, I got much respect for Gator, and let me also again say thank you, Jamil, for the platform. I think the challenge in our community, first of all, politically, is that we don't have a fully developed political class that has made their jobs and has been trained in the ways of being parts of elections and then using that election as a path into an administration to shape policy, which is what Gator talked about. Mm-hmm. Traditionally, that's how it works for white folks. You work on the campaign. After you work on the campaign, you do a good job on the campaign. Then you get an email that sends you a letter that says, hey, tell me what you'd be interested in working in the administration. What is your interest, et cetera? And then You then go in and ideally you're supposed to be able to influence, impact, and help people. That's the way it works for white folks. But for Black people, that's not how it works. For Black people, the way it works politically, particularly in Illinois, is that you get engaged to take people around, to do outreach, to do engagement, to get them in places that they would never be able to get to. But at the end of that, they minimize you and they don't see you as a long-term solution. They see you really as a short-term reason. Like they say, we got to put some money on the streets or whatever. Mm-hmm. And they do that. And then they don't give us, we don't have a substantive position in policy. And so what I think happens for what's happened to us in the Black community when it comes to political accountability is it's usually because there's a lack of money, a lack of resources. We tend to go to the highest bidder or whoever can pay, right? And then once that person pays, I was always, for Black folks, if you get paid, they treat you like a mercenary. And then once they pay you, they say, be gone. If you're a white guy, they pay you and then they say, thank you for your contribution. They bring you in and then you find them being in positions of policy. When it comes to what's in it for the Black people, what we found is that everybody, when they get in trouble, and I'll be honest with you, when JB had his issue, the powers that be in Chicago came to me and said, man, JB sat right in my chair in my office and cried and not cried, but told us how he would never do this. And it was the weakest. And he sat there and he made a lot of promises. And I brought people to him. I brought the What's in it for the Black people family to him because they were all looking at him very jaded once we saw that. But if you look at how many of our Black elected officials and power brokers, as soon as he disrespected us, pushed us to the forefront be standing behind him, right? Without even really demanding any accountability from him. And I think the challenge happens for most of us is because we don't have either the political muscle or the economy. So we wind up selling ourselves, and not necessarily selling ourselves, but choosing the lesser of two evils that winds up leaving us in a situation where we are now. And then just the last thing I want to point out. If you pay attention to all of these politicians, particularly when they hire Black people, they hire Black people that are not from Chicago or not from Illinois. So they don't understand, and what they do is they use those people to say that they do their Black thing, but those Black people are not in tune with us. Their loyalty is to the white person who signed them up as compared to the Black community because they're not from here. So those are some of the things that I've seen in this space. And I just think that really one of the biggest challenges we have is that we do not have a fully developed Black political apparatus that can be, that can help or hurt you. And then because we're underfunded, we wind up finding ourselves, if you want to be political and Black, there's limited people who even can pay you to do the job. So you wind up working for people who don't necessarily have your best interests at hand, or they just want to pay you and be done as compared to utilizing you for your knowledge and expertise for our community.
You know, you make an excellent point. And how do we develop that pipeline to get Black political people who are interested in political futures, interested in the policy making portion of it? And that's so important because we have resolutions all day. You know, you can do resolutions, but when it comes to creating specific policy directed at the Black community, we're sorely lacking in that. What we usually find is someone else creating an ordinance or some kind of policy and we sign on to it. But I'm talking about policy created by Black elected officials targeted to the Black community. And that does not seem to be a strength or something that we develop. And it's no slight to those who come up maybe through the more community activist approach, but we have to develop our policy or policy creative acumen in order to do these things, because that's where I think that we fall short on the benchmark, because even when we get into office, we're not able to create the kind of policy that's needed to affect change.
You know, I agree with you on that, because I've helped create policy, but I did it from a backdoor perspective. I find out what committee an individual is on, and a lot of them be on the committees and don't know the power that they have with making the policy on the committee. Just being hypothetical. Say it's a committee that's dealing with housing, okay? And I can say, look, man, here's a proposal that'll help an individual that's coming out the penitentiary that has learned a trade or willing to learn a trade to take these abandoned buildings and create housing, you know, for ex-felons that's coming out. And there's monies that's readily available from the federal government to the state government that are paid for the services, okay? Once I gave them the information, then they take it and they do it, and next thing I know, it happens.
Right.
But like Mays says, and I agree with him, because he do the same thing. We can tell them what ought to be done, and this is what has to be done. And when they do it, I've learned from to the point you got to almost to get your proper share, you got to let them know, you got to have a retainer for them to ask you what you think. It's to the point, I know Mays be hearing the same thing I be hearing. When they come to you and say, man, what do you think? You grab your head like, wait a minute now, you asking me this here. Let me figure out what I'm going to charge you for my thought.
Well, and I'll say this, and I'll let Mays input. We had Chairman Jason Irvin on last week.
Right.
Well, I appreciate him coming on the show, shared a lot of information. But he made it clear, as an alderman, his primary responsibility is regarding legislation and policy.
Right.
Okay. However, what I'm saying, if that's the primary responsibility, that is not what is created by a lot of our aldermen or elected officials at all level, is the drafting and creation of policy. And so, Mays, I know that you've taken a lot of flack, just as I in certain circles, mm-hmm. because we like to measure the results,
mm-hmm.
not the emotional feeling of having black people in office, but measure the results of the policies that are created that impact the black community. And so when I'm talking now about creating policy specific to help our communities, then why would we have those kind of plain and simple conversations? Is it met with such resistance from the community as if we're trying to harm or tear down the elected officials instead of strengthening and holding them accountable, making us more accountable to this system? That, I mean, after all, we say that everyone, you know, our ancestors died for the vote. Well, the vote has to mean something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I would tell you a couple things. First of all, I think, I've migrated from the position of you got to pay me to tell you what I think, because I have come to a point where however I can help move the ball forward for our people, then that's what I got to do. And then I work around the economics of it. So I've quite frankly, in the political realm, because of I've been so vociferous, very rarely does anybody want to hire me for politics anymore, even though they like my ideas and what I can do. But it's because I have been so vociferous in the fact of what has not been done and what we have not gotten that I've almost been blacklisted in mm-hmm. certain spaces, particularly with black elected officials. Now, when it comes to policy, I'm going to tell you that, firstly, we're locked out of the pipeline. Right. So if you pay attention to what happens, policy, quite frankly, I appreciate Alderman Irvin saying that he's a legislator, but realistically, aldermen, for the most part, are realistically responsible for public safety, picking up the trash and making sure that city services are delivered. The policy component of it comes a little bit, and I'm not going to debate that. But what I find is that oftentimes we're locked out of the pipeline. If you look at white kids, they go to college, right? And then they get a job in Springfield where they become staff and they get on mm-hmm. policy staff or they get on and then they become and they're on a process where they're told to research and learn and figure out how this is going to help. And then they become assets to the elected officials. Those white legislators aren't writing that policy. They got young right. people mm-hmm. running around, digging up, saying, hey, it's just like Washington, D.C. So what happens is our young people are frozen out of that process. So if you go to Springfield and you look, you'll see there's very limited Black staffers. And quite frankly, any of those Black staffers are not on a policy team. They're not making policy. They're not going to the Black elected officials. Now, let me also suggest that our Black elected officials, in some cases, because they have been left out of that pipeline, it becomes embarrassing. Right. I've had elected officials come to me and say, man, Mays, you know why people are so mad about what's in it for the Black people? It's because they know that in 25 years or 30 years, there's really nothing tangible that you can point to that they've been able to accomplish. Mm-hmm. And when that happens, what we find ourselves doing is celebrating the first Black this, the number of Blacks we got doing this, not looking at the policies that they got. And so the white folks will give you the first, as long as that first still sticks with the program. Right. And so the challenge now becomes, is it better for us? Are we still looking to elect the first Black, or are we still holding, do we have these expectations for people because they're Black? Or do we have to now start saying, we have to start electing people directly on policy? I'll tell you up front, I have been the king of, if there's a Black person getting elected against a white person, we got to elect the Black person, right? We got to get in that. But what I would tell you is, politically, my math tells me that if Black people help a white person get over the hump, the white person is more inclined to listen to them than the Black person, because the Black person has been convinced by white folks, you can't be too Black. Yeah. So what winds up happening is the Black guy gets in the spot, or the Black woman gets in the spot, and they get convinced not to be too Black, not to do too many Black policies. And then you find that the white folks use them and they leverage it for their opportunity. So when you see J.B. Pritzker holding his fist up Black power for George Floyd, but at the same time giving you no access to cannabis, you got to say, we lose coming and going. We have got to stop just taking people because we think they're going to win. And we have to start saying, what is the policy before there is any endorsement, period. Right. But I also think we've got to create a pipeline of young, upwardly mobile, educated people who make it their business, that we should be sending kids to college. Let me tell you, in Springfield, these white kids, they're known by people. They get sent to school. They then come and get a scholarship or some sort of way to help them through. They come work on the speaker staff for 3, 5, 7, 10 years. After they work on 3, 5, 7, 10 years, then they go to law school, get a law degree, and then they go on. But they're always there to be of assistance for those people, the white elected officials. For us, we don't have that pipeline. And quite frankly, we don't think of, I think that our Black elected officials are, because there is a lack of money and power in our community, they have become essentially Black royalty with no accountability, right? Because they get to, when they go to Springfield, all those lobbyists tell them how great they are, and they tell them, oh, we'll give you criminal justice reform, oh, we'll give you all of these things, when there's no economics. But they have a bunch of white folks, because there's no real Black lobbyists down in Springfield who are pushing our policies. Think about it, Jamil. How many Black lobbyists are in Springfield that are policy driven, that are pushing an agenda forward? And so when you see that we don't have anybody down there doing that, essentially because the legislators don't write the bills, the staff does it, or lobbyists or people come to them and present it. And the challenge now is, like, when do we just start to establish our own pipeline?
Yeah. And you're so right. And because that goes to what we were talking about off the air, I mean, before we started, is that part of this is, how do you strengthen and equip the Black elected officials with the tools and resources they need to affect change? And
that's, they got to know they need it, though.
They got to know that they need it. And you're absolutely right. And I've seen it in the last 15 to 20 years, Mays and Gator. Mm-hmm. We've seen the Latino community begin to amass that power, that pipeline amongst themselves, and have become, you know, at least in the last 8 that I know, have been able to come to the table to say, no, we want X, Y, Z, and openly, without unapologetically, be able to ask for things specific to their community. And so they've emulated some things, but how do we galvanize that? And I think what happens is, to what you said earlier, when we get into positions, the first or second thing we have to do is make it appear like, hey, we're looking for policies for everyone. We're going to water down what's needed in the black community just to show you that I could be there for everybody. Other elected officials, that's expected. They don't have to say that or go out of their way for that, but it seems that we have to do that. And so you're right, we have to begin to create that pipeline at that. And what's interesting, Mays, I know a lot of young, whether it's the young Democrats, a lot of young people who are interested in policy, but we have to, they have to be shown how to create that policy and get those jobs or be in that environment to do that. Go ahead.
Can I also point out that there are a lot of young black people who want to be involved in politics and want to help, but they don't want to have to be bent over. They do not want to have to be made to bow down to white power and privilege, or to kiss the tails of white people who they are, who they feel like they have the same level of intellect for. So often our young black people are seeing the outcomes of what has been our political system. So as you're trying to recruit people, like, I think of trying to encourage young black men to be a part of the Democratic political process. And then you gotta, and then you tell a person you want them to join the Democratic Party, and they say, wait a minute, y'all just get passed a $1 billion cannabis bill, and we got nothing. The mayor, the governor, everybody told y'all to kick rocks. Y'all gave them y'all votes, and now we supposed to be standing up fighting for y'all. And so the challenge is, if you want a strong black man or a strong black woman, they know when they're being screwed. And oftentimes we got black elected officials trying to sell us that the screwing really is a good thing.
Yeah. Princess, I want to remind you all that this is a live call-in show. If you have a question or a comment, please give us a call at 773-434-6625. And I want to go to you, because earlier you were alluding to Governor Pritzker, and we're talking about the nursing home.
Right.
That has become, it's always been a huge source of conversation, but especially during this pandemic, it's become really to the forefront. So elaborate a little bit on that.
You know, one of the things, I was helping this woman, a friend of mine, Loretta Brady. Her mother was named Lottie Smith. And me and Andrew did a press conference because her mother was being abused in the nursing home right before the COVID. So I was seeing it up front, what was happening. And then I realized there was a law on the books where the state's attorneys can go in and the attorney general can go in and get rid of the bad administration and get everything right. And I saw where the governor wasn't enforcing this law. Couldn't understand it. Then when I saw that he was pushing some type of legislation to say that the nursing home shouldn't be held liable if someone got infected with a disease and they died. I couldn't understand that. Then when I saw here recently to enforce the law that they had on there from 2010 to come up with a fine to charge the nursing home, they were supposed to went into effect January the 1st. Right. They have a meeting in December to say we're not going to fine them until the middle of July. And that's when I said that we got to look into this, because the majority of the people that I was finding that was dying in the nursing homes were African Americans, be they employees, be they residents. And the one thing that really got my gut, I gave information to JAB's administration. I do my due diligence. You ain't gonna be able to say you didn't know nothing about it. Right. You know what I mean? Okay. Was that the elected officials, There were state reps or state senators, even aldermen, where the nursing homes were in their communities doing all this badness, and they were silent. You find what I'm saying? I couldn't understand that. Okay, so then I just started my campaign, just like the shirt you see me wear on now, just like I was wearing JB, elect JB. I'm wearing this to tell JB, it's encompassing on you, not Trump, to enforce that law that can save lives, especially during this pandemic. And for him to have the power to do it, that's what I was saying about policy. Sometimes you got to make them be about the law. And a lot of our elected officials, I'm not knocking them, I'm just stating the fact, constructive criticism. When they have the town hall meetings to hear what's happening, and they, for some reason, they don't listen to what the body of people are saying. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Being hypothetical. If you get the block to stay clean, if you had a garbage can in all four corners. Okay, they have to write a policy to get a budget to get that. Okay, right. I'm just being hypothetical. Right. Then they got a clean community. But it made me, I'm hearing them saying about ComEd and Madigan. And I'm saying, okay, how many people died from screwing a light bulb in? But no one want to talk about the lobbyists in the nursing home that got it where the governor won't enforce the law. They got it where a governor is trying to find all kind of ways for them to get more money. 2018, I found out he gave the nursing home industry $240 million.
Well, and I know the nursing home owners are their lobbyists because they have people down there. The owners are saying that they need they need more resources of time to hire staff to meet that. And I know everyone has an excuse or reason for that. But you're right, particularly in our community, the nursing homes. In fact, COVID and the people who have succumbed to the pandemic, you know, they're putting out the numbers, but
they don't want to tell.
But before, there's still a lot of things going on. And Mays, what have you heard maybe from some of your viewers or things about the nursing home situations, or is this a topic that that has been picked up on in our communities? Have you heard much about it?
You know, we haven't talked a tremendous amount about nursing homes mm-hmm. in my space, mm-hmm. with the exception of the fact that we know that our people are dying disproportionately as the service providers, as well as the people that are inside of those nursing homes. Mm-hmm. The challenge, one of the things that I look at is oftentimes the people that profit off of the, not the high end, high quality nursing homes, but the ones that are government and state funded. Mm-hmm. And so they spend a tremendous amount of money, but there's also long relationships. And I'm going to tell you, if you look at who are the owners of the nursing homes, right? And who are these? They are multi-million dollar international, and they fit right in that space that JB mm-hmm. and his cohorts are in. I think when we talk about nursing homes, I think it's just, I think when you look at this, Black people are expendable, right? Like Black people to these white folks are expendable. And so when we talk about the lobbyists fighting for nursing homes and protecting them, it is really about economics, completely all the way around. And I think when we take that, when we don't acknowledge that, I think that's when our whole thing goes to the left. The fact of the matter is, those people, I'm going to tell you, COVID has been profitable, probably for nursing homes, right?
Yeah.
With the death, with the additional funding, with all of that. And so I think that what I've always said, that Black death is a hustle. And again, where is the outrage? Where are the Black elected officials that are jumping up and down saying, damn, we know that if you look at where all these deaths are coming from, they're coming from our neighborhoods. But yet we got people sitting around chilling, talking about other things. And it we have not become a priority to black folks, period, to our black elected officials. And I think as long as they got those white lobbyists telling them, oh, you did a great job fighting for them. Oh, you gave another $240 million to nursing homes. We looking at it like, oh, we did something to save lives. The white boy is looking like, how can I reappropriate this $250 million so that I don't have to be responsible for all these people that are dying?
Well said.
Well said.
I want to go to the call. We have a couple of callers on the line. So, caller, you're on the line with Maze Jackson and Gator Bradley.
Hi. Hi. My name is Loretta Brady.
Hello, Ms.
Hey,
Brady.
Hey, Loretta.
Hey, I'm calling about my mother, Lottie Smith, that had a horrific death in the nursing home at Salva Westchester Health and Rehabilitation in Westchester, Illinois. My mother was beat up. Mother, black eye, choked. I've been dealing with this since last year. I have over 500 pictures. I know the system, how I work in the state, because I'm a retired state worker for 37 years, okay?
Yes.
My mother died at a horrific death. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to see nobody die, pass away with the abuse as my mother had. My mother's been in the hospital 21 times. And they said they was going to kill her because my mouth was so big. And I have written public health, talked to the governor's office. Nobody did anything. My mother passed away with an unstageable bed sore that took the bloodstream in her, the bloodstream went to her kidneys, has what you call Staph MRSA, and went to her kidneys and shut it down. I had police reports. Mm-hmm. Nobody did anything. Mm-hmm. I called everybody. My mother, on her last day, before she died, she told the hospice nurse at the nursing home, but it wasn't the hospice CNA, she said, please don't hit me no more. My mother had dementia, and she knew they was beating her, and they was laughing. And they said, since I had a big knife, you do whatever you want to do to a letter on the floor. My mother died as a horrific death. And when she died, she just looked up in the air. Nobody helped me. The public health never came in. When they came in, I gave them all kind of documentation. They didn't never use them. And I watched. My mother beat COVID. I got pictures of her with a hidden camera. But 2 hours away from her dying, I called. I said, how's she doing? They said, oh, she up to these, but my mother is in the bed dying. She went to the hospital with 140 heart rate. Oxygen down to 75. She was on a incubator, you know, and then she beat that. They came back, and they let her fall again. You look at Chicago sometimes, she had a black eye. They beat her. They smothered her, and we couldn't move them, and they killed her. And all they did, they didn't get rid of them. They got rid of some of them. What they did, they promoted them. Mm-hmm. So now public health failed me. The governor failed me. They kept telling me to send them pictures. I got pictures, and what took her out of here was an unstageable. Anybody know about an unstageable wound? They know that can kill you. It was so bad, it couldn't be. So I need help. I got a lawsuit in, but the elected officials that I ain't worked with, nobody did anything but except for five, but Cook County tried to help me. Tony Pratt Record, they tried to help. But my mother is dead now. Yeah. And the lady that been supposed to be working with her, that we filed police reports, snuck in her room on September the 25th and fed her, and that what took her out. She couldn't talk no more. And they snatched out her pick line. And they snatched out the G2. So where do we go?
Yes, ma'am. Ms. Brady, I'm so sorry for your mother and your entire ordeal with that. And I know that Brother Gator was talking to me off camera about the situation. I would love to follow up with you directly to speak more about your specific situation and make sure that we do whatever we can on our platform and our resources to not only share your story, but to put pressure on those to make sure that they evaluate it and address it. Nothing will bring back your mother,
but to make sure that this is not something that's just discarded under the rug. And so I would like if you would give me that opportunity to let me give you a call and speak with you directly about that situation. Yes. And see what we could do. I'm going to have them, hopefully they can pick up the other line and get your contact information, and I will follow up with you later this evening after this show, okay?
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Okay. And, you know, there's a lot to be said, but these are the real life impact stories that are behind the headlines.
Right.
You know, as this sister described, and you can hear the pain in the voice and the helplessness, and, you know, it's sad because she said that she has the picture, she has the video, she's given it to people, but it hasn't caused the outrage or the sense of urgency to look at it, because remember, this is one instance.
Man, a bunch of
but there could be many more. And so that is unfortunate, and we have to do something about that. I'm gonna go on to the next caller. Caller, you're on the line. Right? No, we don't have a caller. And you know, Gator, I know that you're close to the situation. I know, Maze, what thoughts come to mind when you hear the sister talk about that ordeal?
You know, the thoughts that come to mind is, who are her advocates, right? Like, what office does she, who is her champion? Who is the person? So she said Westchester, right? So Westchester makes me think two things. It makes me think leader Kimberly Lightfoot, right? And it makes me think of State Representative Chris Welch.
Yeah.
Both of them, two of the most powerful legislators in the state. And thinking that something like that happened in that area, she should be able to go to them, right? The fact that that one of them should be able to call and strike the fear of God in either that nursing homes or at the Department of Public Health, etc. The other thing that comes to my mind is Dr. Ezekiel, and our, again, we kind of applaud, we applaud surface stuff. So we all get excited when Dr. Ezekiel speaks in Spanish and gets up there and, you know, says her thing. But where it, when it comes down to Black death, right? Mm-hmm. What has been her policy or plan to address it? Knowing that, right, we got JB pushing to the forefront of all of this COVID, Dr. Ezekiel. Mm-hmm. But we know that Black people are dying disproportionately at this point. And we haven't seen anything specific to address Black folks, Black people, even though we've got this person, and y'all give her the, oh yeah, let's go, sister girl, because she busted down the Spanish version of it, and she gets up and JB allows her to be the face of it. Right. But in my estimation, Dr. Ezekiel and all of these elected officials should have a special, should have some sort of concern for Black folks that makes them say, besides my regular job, I'm going to make sure that I put this, I'm going to make, how do we deal with these Black deaths a priority? And I don't see that from any of our elected officials.
Right.
You're right.
You know, I want to piggyback on that, Maze. You're 100% correct. How we were able to get the attention was that Brandon Johnson, the Cook County Commissioner, Okay, he was about pushing a resolution on it because, you know, the county hospital can just do so much.
Right.
Okay. So it wasn't in Brandon's district, but Loretta was Brandon's constituent.
Right. Loretta Hospital.
Loretta Brady.
Brady, right.
So that's what made him get involved and put a resolution together called Save Our Seniors. Based on this, for it to be an apparatus for them to be able to tell the Illinois Department of Public Health from the Cook County, saying this is what you need to do. For the governor, for the attorney general, we wrote the letters, gave them the pictures and everything else. So Brandon Johnson was able to get the other 16 Cook County commissioners and the county board president to agree to the resolution to go to the next level. But if the governor don't enforce the law, their hands are tied. They can't go. The attorney general can't do nothing. Knowing that it's wrong. If his mother was in there, he couldn't do nothing because he didn't push this law.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So the thing becomes just like what Mays was saying.
But can I jump in right there, guys? Real quick. The thing that I gotta, and I gotta, and Jamil, you mentioned this before, and Gator, it's no shade to Commissioner Johnson, but I think that our elected officials are adept at kind of sending us off. Right? At kind of like when something comes like this, they put a resolution together, right? Because a resolution is real simple, right? You write it up. It doesn't require any work. It doesn't require any policy change. It just says, hey, we hope that this will happen, or we're telling you that we know this happens. And again, that to me is the typically how we get treated. We don't get people that say, okay, we're going to change a law. We're going to make a substantive policy change. So if that means that at Loretto Hospital, which is in the realm of Cook County, this is how we can impact them, and this is what we're going to, how we're going to use the law to leverage that. No, what they say is, ooh, I'm going to give you a resolution that sounds good, that you can read on TV and that everybody says yes, but a resolution actually means nothing. It really is, let me not say nothing. It means we acknowledge it, but right. We're not actually taking, it's ceremonial. Right. And we get ceremonial and symbolism, and then we wind up wondering why. We got 3 million resolutions that everybody get. I bet you talk to any black elected official about a problem, they'll run you a resolution so quick it ain't even funny.
Right, but Mays, but on that, this resolution that we did was help to formulate policy. The reason I'm saying that, it only for the county to come and show what they could do to aid and assist Loretta, because
they
get, listen to me. The Welch and Welch, whatever they is, Lifeford or whatever the other, the representatives were the ones that supposed to have, took that and went to JB and said, you got to enforce this law because our people are saying something. They said nothing. You know what I'm saying?
But the resolution was simply stated that we as a Cook County
Board is saying that this is what you got to do.
Want you to enforce the
right
on the book.
Right.
But still, it's a request, it's a gesture, but there's no accountability with the resolution except to say that we asked for it. And I think that's what Mays is saying.
Right.
And so, but you're right. At the state legislative body.
Right, the state legislative body, in other words.
Should take that as an indication to do something. But to May's point, if the, because Westchester, I believe, is still in
Cook County.
Right.
Right.
So if they created a law
right. To
say, you know, nurse homes within Cook County, such and such and such and such.
See, right. Yeah. See, you know, but this is what I'm finding out. The aldermen don't talk to the commissioners. The commissioners don't really talk to the legislators. You know what I mean? Now, the Hispanic community,
well,
all of them talk.
They talk because I see them a lot.
Right.
They may not talk about policy stuff.
Yeah, they'll, okay.
But they talk about
certain things. Let me tell you what they do. Can I jump in that? Yeah. I got to push back on that, Gator. They do talk. They got the Joint Black Caucus, remember? That's what Larry Rogers put together so that all of the people that weren't part of the Black Caucus in Springfield or the Black Caucus Aldermanic, they all go meet once a month with Larry Rogers and that whole group. And
I'm suggesting that,
hold on, let me finish. Yeah. And I'm suggesting that in the 3 years that we've seen that group meeting, have we ever seen any joint policy come out that has benefited black people at all?
No.
And so when we talk about these people giving resolutions, understand that the resolution ain't moving, no, it's not changing a law. A resolution is, hey, we'd like you to. Instead of all of them black elected officials getting together and saying, city, county, and state, this is what we can do collectively to move the ball forward, and they can't go around us, No. What winds up happening is they give you a resolution, and because we tend to be so uninformed about how this process works, we get excited about the resolution. Remember, you get a resolution when you die.
And I think to your point, and when we have to go back to the root mm-hmm. problem, is that if we're not, if we don't have the resources or the skill or the young staffers to create and write that policy, it's easier to write resolutions than it is to create policy that has to be voted and enacted on, and that's where we fall short and become derelict.
Right. You know, my thing is this, man. Like May saying about this joint, it seems like that's a cocktail party that they have. Let's all come on and see who's going to pay the tab for the next drink. You know what I mean? So at that point, because I'm glad he made me aware of that, it's encompassing on us to let the people that's voting for them, to let them know this is what we expect of them as they having that little one day a month meeting, and then to let us know what did they meet about that's going to enhance our lives better. Because you got to start somewhere.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
You have to start somewhere, but there is a way to strengthen and support too. Because, and I'll say this, just like General Iron, if you all have been paying attention to General Iron up there, I want to say in the 43rd World and boarding mm-hmm. the Second World War, those constituents kept calling in, writing their aldermen, calling in to every city council meeting, and now General Iron is shut down.
Right.
Albeit there was a fire there, but they
right. Right, but they pushing it to the south
but
side.
But they pushed right. it south side, 10th Ward.
All right, but they, exactly. But what I'm saying is that that community rallied around that. Now, what we have to do is have that same kind of pressure, same kind of engagement as well. But I know you wanted to say something before I said that, May, so go ahead.
No, I just think that we have got, we are in a position where, right, like most of these elected officials have been patted on the back by the people who disenfranchise us, right? Mm-hmm. So what you find out is that most of these elected officials, the people that fund them, that finance them, that help them are the rich white people, right? Because once you're an elected official, you're not in the same class with black elected officials. I mean, with black people. And you mm-hmm. become, you start to act like royalty. And if people challenge you, it's almost like you'd rather cut them off than really listen. So, and to me, I just think it's kind of crazy that at this point that, think about this, George Floyd, think about all of the things that have happened in the past year, to black people specifically. We have, from George Floyd, there has been no substantive policy change. There has been no substantive action. There has been nothing that has been made better for black people through an elective process this whole time. Nothing. And I asked, and I'm just gonna go, because we've put this challenge to people before. What could you tell me is the most significant black accomplishment politically over the last 10 years? When you saw State Senator Kimberly Lightfoot, the chairman of the Black Caucus, say that she was surprised to find out that after 10 years of passing laws, that absolutely nothing had changed. That to me, I couldn't even believe that they said that out loud. Because it's very frustrating. I'll just put it that way. It's just very frustrating.
It's frustrating. It's sad, and it's embarrassing, to be quite honest, because in the last 10 years, and with everything, it becomes symbolism. Mm-hmm. And the shame of it is that, as you said this year, and I've said this on the show, this year, of all years, you could have asked, I don't care if it was reparations, I don't care what it was, you could have asked for something. And this is what I hold black people accountable for here. Whenever someone in the community challenges the status quo, we have an issue with it.
Mm-hmm.
Because, and I'll give you an example, even for posing the question, and I use the example of Ice Cube, just as a thing. Mm-hmm. I don't care whether Trump said it, but just for somebody to say, hey, let's put a platform for it to see who will listen. And it was black people who attacked Ice Cube. It wasn't Caucasian people. You look at Kyrie Irving, an NBA player who questions certain things, just want to buck the system. Basically, it's black people who told him to shut up and dribble, just like when they had the outrage when the Caucasian reporter said the same thing. Black people, we have selective outrage. We want to push the system unless you're questioning the approved or the Caucasian people that we say are okay. And so that's what I'm saying, Maze, is that in 10 years, it's the same cycle. We look at the symbolism. You can't speak publicly about President Barack Obama and measure the results to see who benefited from his presidency without black people attacking you all over the place. And so what I'm saying, when are we gonna wanna have a real conversation about measuring results as opposed to the symbolism of having someone in office? Because what you've seen in the last 8 years is we have put President Trump as an individual to make it seem like all disparity happened, all wrong mistreatment of black people has happened since Trump has been in office, when black people have been killed long before then. And so it's a diversionary thing, man, and we just have to get serious about the condition of our people, period. And I know that we're running out of time, but before then, Maze and Gate, I want you to both talk about your platform. Maze, if people want to find out more information or listen to your show, where can they go to?
So check it out. You can go to so check this out. Things are changing. We're off the air until January 18th. We'll be back launching everything, new lineup, new shows on the What's in It for the Black People media page on Facebook. You can also check me out on the Maze Jackson page, as well as you can get me on YouTube, Twitter, and Twitch. We ask the question every single day, what's in it for the black people? And I'm going to ask you all to make sure that you register, subscribe to the What's in It for the Black People media page.
Gotcha. All right, brother.
Hey,
Gator.
You call Gator, you get up with me by dialing 312-371-6914. 312-371-6914. Mm-hmm. Facebook, I'm Wallace Bradley. Y'all know I'm the urban translator, host of the Bradley Report.
All right.
But hey, in between time, call your state rep, state senator, and call the governor and tell him enforce the Nursing Home Care Act, Section 8.
All right. Brothers and sisters, and on behalf of Crow, you give us a call at 973-925-1600. On behalf of Wallace Gator Bradley, Maze Jackson, and the entire Crow Television production team, I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad, leaving you with the greetings of peace and paradise of Assalamu Alaikum.